I'm going to talk to you about the Great Barrier Reef. The Great Barrier Reef is located in Australia and it's facing quite a few issues at the moment. And in fact, you may have heard of some of these in the media. There is a lot of media presence concerned with the state of the Great Barrier Reef at the moment. There is coral bleaching happening, but the media allows us to believe possibly that it's worse, that it is worse than it is. It is important that you actually look and find the true information to see what is happening on the reef at the moment. So in this presentation, I'm going to talk to you about the Great Barrier Reef. I'm going to tell you what a coral is and what coral bleaching actually is. I'm going to look at what's actually happening on the reef in terms of damage and coral bleaching to that area, the monetary value of the reef, as well as what we can do to save the Great Barrier Reef. So first of all, the Great Barrier Reef is located in Australia along the east coast of Queensland. It is extremely large, and in fact it's the equivalent size of 70 million football fields. And if that doesn't mean much to you, you can put it in perspective of countries of the world. It's the same size as Italy, or Japan, or Germany, or Malaysia. It is home to over 3,000 coral reefs, 600 different continental islands, and we have numerous species of fish, many of them that are endemic to that area alone. You can see here the size of the Great Barrier Reef, where it actually is located in Australia, and then the size comparison in Europe and North America. So what is a coral? Corals are actually made up of polyps, and a polyp is like an upside down jellyfish. So magnified, that's what it would look like. The actual coral colony is made up of hundreds and thousands of those, and if you think of a coral colony as like an apartment block of many layers of these different coral colonies. Inside the polyp tissue is an algae that's called zooxanthellae, a very difficult word to remember. So if you remember it as the symbiotic algae that lives inside the coral. So it does two things. One, it gives the colour to the coral, and then the coral in return provides food for the algae. So they live together symbiotically and really can't live without each other. So coral bleaching happens when the coral becomes stressed. So stress can be caused by an increase in water temperature, which is the thing that we hear about most often. It can also be caused by a decrease in water temperature and a reduction in the water quality that may be caused from the runoff from coastal areas or farmland on the coast. So what happens is that the zooxanthellae is ejected from the coral base when the coral becomes stressed. So that's when we get that bleached look. So it basically ejects the zooxanthellae and then it loses all the colour which the algae has previously provided. It can recover, or it can die. So it depends on what happens thereafter. So if the water stays at that, if it's caused by an increase in temperature, if the water stays at that temperature for too long, then that algae will not return to the coral and the coral will eventually die. But it can actually recover if the water reduces, if that temperature is then reduced to its previous levels, which is then not a problem and the coral can continue living. And in fact, coral bleaching is a naturally occurring event. Some of the things that actually cause coral bleaching are an increase in carbon emissions, an increase in issues with climate change, this rising sea temperatures, the frequency and the severity of bleaching events. So as I said, it is a naturally occurring event, but recently, over the past years, there have been more of these events, and that's where the problems arise. So you can see here on this map, this is a map that comes from NOAA, and you can see where the water temperatures are the highest. So this is at a particular, this is a snapshot, as it says here, this is in July to October from 2016, and those really red areas are where the water temperature is up to about 4 degrees higher than it actually normally is. So the impact of climate change and this increase in water temperature in the Great Barrier Reef has seen 22% to 35% of corals lost across the Great Barrier Reef. Unfortunately, the temperature has not reduced sufficiently for the coral to regenerate and attract back that zooxanthellae to recreate its colour. So, unfortunately, then it does die. And this has occurred because there have been these back-to-back bleaching events. And the reef really is too valuable to lose. We really need to do what we can to protect it. And we do have some power in that. But let's just have a look at the actual value of the reef. It is said to produce $6 billion a year in income, 64,000 jobs in tourism. That's direct tourism jobs, as well as those services that are related to tourism. But is this really the real number? Can we really put a monetary value on the value of the Great Barrier Reef? There are many other factors that we need to consider. So it does deliver a suite of ecosystem services. So we're looking at fishing, not just recreational, but commercial fishing. Coastal protection. The reef provides coastal protection. So if we have a reef that's near the coast, basically if there are big storms, that kind of thing, it will reduce the amount of water, reduce the ocean swell coming onto the land. So it protects coastal areas. So if there is no reef, then the water damage that can occur on those coastal areas can be increased. It does, unfortunately, in the process damage the reef. However, it is of great value to those coastal areas to keep them protected. From a recreational and tourism perspective, it obviously has a lot of value as well. And then, of course, habitat and biodiversity of all of this marine life that we mentioned earlier that actually lives in the Great Barrier Reef area. This is also reducing as the coral bleaches and dies. So there have been lots of studies completed to suggest the actual monetary value of the Great Barrier Reef. But the question really is how do we actually put an actual monetary value onto it? One third of all fish species, they spend part of their life on the Great Barrier Reef or in a reef. So a lot of fish, when they're babies, their habitats or their are in mangroves along coastal areas. And then as they get older, they will move into the reef areas. In some countries, about 50% of their protein comes from a reef. So basically, it is a possible huge humanitarian crisis if our reefs die. Because of course, it's not just the Great Barrier Reef that's affected by coral bleaching and similar effects of deteriorated water quality. It's reefs all over the world. And a lot of developing countries especially rely on fish from reef areas for their actual protein source. And there is also then the element of the spiritual and or emotional well-being of us, of humans as a species, and how we relate. If we think of indigenous cultures, they rely heavily not just on food, but also the spiritual and cultural value of that region. So what's the answer? It's difficult. There's a lot of blame placed on industries. There's a blame placed on the mining industry, on agriculture. They need to make changes. Yes, they do, but we can't control that so much as an individual. We can persuade, we can sign petitions, we can persuade governments that they need to be putting more legislation, more policy in place, that different fertilizers, etc., are used by farms. Maybe that mines are not set up in different areas that potentially affect the reef. But we don't have as much control as individuals about that. We can certainly try and persuade those higher up to do something about it, but that's all we can do is try. Renewable energy is the key. So at the moment, in Australia especially, we are not forced to have solar power. And a lot of people are against solar power or other renewable power sources because they think that it's going to cost too much money. But in fact, if we were to change to renewable energy, it would create more jobs for Australians. So we talk about mines being put in and that the jobs that it's going to create. But the reality is that renewable energies will actually create more jobs and at the same time help reduce the effects of global warming and climate change. Many countries around the world are already taking on renewable energy, and countries like China and India, with the biggest populations in the world, are very passionate and very strict about their renewable energy sources. So what can we do? What must we do? So we are in a cycle now of every 15 years or less of bleaching events. So to stop that, we need to reduce the effect of global warming and climate change. And the larger problem of climate change is being ignored and sidelined and favoured of the easy fix solution. So we need to put more steps in place that will have a long-term benefit for the protection of the Great Barrier Reef. So without accelerated action on climate change and the use of fossil fuels, there will be no Great Barrier Reef in 2050. So really, what will we say to our children, to our future generations? So we are violating the rights of nature. We need to do a better job and work together as a community. Can an individual make a difference? Yes, they can, but it needs to be collective. We must look and learn from nature. We need to rebuild your future if we're talking to our children, and the future that we owe nature for her gifts to us. So what the Great Barrier Reef has given to us, we need to repay that by looking after the Great Barrier Reef itself. So what can you do on an individual level to help? You can educate yourself on the issues that are affecting the Great Barrier Reef and then educate others, tell other people. If you can, come to the Great Barrier Reef. You've got time. There are plenty of beautiful areas where the Great Barrier Reef is still pristine. On an individual level at home, recycle, reuse, reduce, eliminate your plastic use. Reduce your car use, walk a little bit more. Get a bicycle for those short distances, why not? Pick up litter. A lot of that litter that we see lying on the street will wash straight into a river, which goes out into the ocean and then can cause, again, a degradation in water quality, which can stress the corals and cause more coral bleaching. And connecting with nature, whether you come to the Great Barrier Reef or if you can't come to the Great Barrier Reef, just go and have a walk in a forest and reconnect with nature and get that feeling of what you can possibly do, of its beauty, and then think about what you can do to help. So I hope that you've learned something here, and do what you can. Every little bit helps. Thank you.